On behalf of the board and members of the POW-MIA Museum of Jefferson Barracks, Missouri, it is my privilege to welcome you as we celebrate this day, May 11th, 2021, as Lieutenant Michael J. Blassie Day, by proclamation of the Honorable Michael L. Parson, Governor, State of Missouri. This day has been made possible due to the spirit and dedication of the United States Air Force Academy class of 1970. Its members are honored to recognize their classmate, Mike Blassie, and the others among their ranks who fell in battle or were captured and held as prisoners of war during the Vietnam War. My name is Kathy Lawton Brown. I'm an Air Force veteran who served during the Vietnam era, and it is my distinct honor to serve as your MC today. In this presentation, you will learn about Jefferson Barracks, the POW-MIA Museum, and its mission of educate, honor, and remember. You will then meet Lieutenant Michael J. Mike Blassie, learn of his heroism as an A-37 pilot, and be touched by his unique service to our country as the one who rested for 14 years in the Tomb of the Unknown at Arlington National Cemetery. You will get to know the man Mike through the eyes of his sister Patricia, a retired Air Force colonel, and see and appreciate him as his academy classmates did in the prime of his life. Please join me now in welcoming a gentleman whose own father was held as a POW during the Second World War, the president of Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum, Mr. Paul Dillon.
Welcome to the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum project. We are located at 1618 Hancock Avenue in the historic district of Jefferson Barracks. We're right around the corner from the Civil War Museum, next door to the Jefferson Barracks Telephone Pioneers Museum, and right across the street from the Jefferson Barracks Air and National Guard facility, right behind me. A little bit about Jefferson Barracks. It's the oldest operating military installation west of the Mississippi River. It was established in 1826 as a military outpost downriver from the French fur trading settlement known as Laclede's Landing, better known today as St. Louis, Missouri. Jefferson Barracks is the birthplace of the U.S. Cavalry. The first military parachute jump was made here at Jefferson Barracks in 1912. Before the Civil War, Ulysses S. Grant and Robert E. Lee both saw service here at Jefferson Barracks. During the Civil War, Jefferson Barracks was a hospital, and following the Civil War, wounded former prisoners of war from both the North and the South recuperated here at Jefferson Barracks. During World War I and World War II, it was a basic training facility. And now, currently, it is a joint Air and National Guard base under the command of the U.S. Air Force. And the history of Jefferson Barracks is continuing to be written as Air and National Guardsmen and women are deployed from Jefferson Barracks into harm's way to protect us and the freedoms that we cherish so much. A little bit about the building itself. It was formerly known as the old 1896 Officers' Quarters Building. It is one of two remaining junior officers' billets that used to line Hancock Avenue on the north side of the road. Although it is formerly known as the old 1896 Officers' Quarters Building, the architects who did the initial survey of the building for the museum believes that it was actually built in 1848. But 1846, the building has been here for quite a while. For a time, up until 2008, it housed the Civilian Conservation Corps Museum. From 2008 until January of 2013, when we obtained the keys of the building, it was unoccupied and unattended to and in pretty much need of some tender loving care.
Although the museum is currently undergoing a much needed restoration and renovation, we're striving to remain as active as possible with regards to POW-MIA awareness. Some of the activities we've been able to pursue are, we've installed a memorial brick paver area in front of the museum, honoring our POWs, our MIAs and their families, other veterans, veterans groups, supporters, and friends of the museum. We've erected a replica POW guard tower just east of the building, enclosed in a stockade fence topped with barbed wire to remind passersby of the very special sacrifices made on our behalf. We've established a POW-MIA city program modeled after the Purple Heart City program, which has in turn expanded into a POW-MIA county and a POW-MIA campus program, with the Hillsborough R3 School District becoming our first POW-MIA campus, followed shortly after by the College of the Ozarks. In 2019, at the behest of the museum, Missouri Governor Mike Parson proclaimed Missouri a POW-MIA state, recognizing Missouri's commitment to POW-MIA awareness. We've partnered with the noted children's book author Nancy Polite and Elva Risa Publishing to produce what we think is the first child-friendly book about the POW-MIA experience. The book, entitled In Is for Never Forget, was selected as a finalist in the Forward Indies Independent Publishers 2017 Juvenile Nonfiction Book of the Year category. It did not win, but we're very proud of the story that it tells. In February of 2020, we were gifted with an actual piece of USS Arizona, along with a sample of the water and oil still leaking from her hull, and an American flag that was flown over the USS Arizona Memorial. The display case for the relic and the items was the Eagle Scout project of Eagle Scout Chase Hatch of Troop 419 in Arnold, Missouri. We have hosted multiple national POW-MIA Recognition Day ceremonies featuring speakers such as U.S. Congressman Russ Carnahan, Missouri Secretary of State Jay Ashcroft, Major General Cassie Strom, Colonel John Clark, shot down over North Vietnam in 1967 and a prisoner of war for 6 years, Skip Schumacher, Silver Star recipient and the operations officer aboard the USS Pueblo when it was seized by North Korea in 1968, Marine Sergeant Rocky Sickman, held for 444 days by the Iranians when they seized the American embassy in Tehran, Sergeant Major Robert Sharp, survivor of the Suncheon Tunnel Massacre in Korea during the Korean War, and Mary Blassie Hart and George Blassie, sister and brother of Mike Blassie. The museum facilitated the French Legion of Honor medal presentation ceremony for former World War II prisoners of war Bill Kelm and Hal Roth. Bill Kelm served with the 3rd Infantry Division and was captured in France in an area known as the Bloody Colmar Pocket during World War II. Hal Roth served with the 1st Infantry Division, and he waded ashore at Omaha Beach with the second wave on D-Day, and he was captured about a month later in Laval, France. Some of the pre-COVID fundraising activities we have initiated are helmet drives, events at Busch Stadium, courtesy of museum board member, the late Bill Gunny Kiefer, motorcycle runs, trivia nights, murder mystery dinners, just to name a few. And of course, we are continuing to collect as much POW-MIA related information and stories as we can, putting names, faces, and stories to that silhouette on the POW-MIA flag.
The pandemic of 2020 severely hampered the museum's fundraising and restoration, renovation, construction activities. However, we are continuing to move forward as best we can. The mission of the museum is the same as it was when the project started, to create a place where every day is POW-MIA Recognition Day, and to put names, faces, and stories to that silhouette on the POW-MIA flag. On behalf of the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum, we are very much looking forward to meeting you all in person and telling you the stories.
Thank you, Paul. I'm honored to now introduce to you Lieutenant Mike Blassie's sister, Colonel Patricia Blassie, United States Air Force, retired, as we discuss her older brother and the profound influence he had upon her life. I know it still must be incredibly difficult to speak about even after all these years, but would you please share with us when and how you were informed of Mike being listed KIA BNR?
I don't think I'll ever forget that day, Kathy. I am 10 years younger than my brother, Michael. So he was 24 when he was shot down and killed over Vietnam. I was 14. And I had come home early from school that day. And I heard something outside, and it wasn't like I should have been home from school. But I heard something outside, and I looked out the window, and there were these Air Force people in their uniforms with my mom and dad. And I was so, oh my goodness, you know, I wasn't supposed to be at home. So I went out into the backyard and waited, where there was a neighbor, Mrs. Leeser, across the street, who knows everything that goes on in the neighborhood. And the next thing I knew, she came in the backyard and she said, "Pat, you need to go inside." And I said, "Well, what is it? You know, what happened?" And she goes, "You just need to go inside." So I did. And it was just as if you see it in the movies, you know, where a team comes to a family's home to discuss what happened, when it happened to their family member during a wartime situation. And that's exactly what they did. They had picked up went to my dad's work. They went and then picked up my mom from her work, brought them back to the home. I walked in, they didn't even really notice that I wasn't supposed to be at home because of the devastation of learning that Michael had been killed. And it's just as you said, that's what they told us that day, his plane was hit. The flight lead gave us a firsthand account. He saw Michael go in, and there was no communication. They didn't see him eject. And so his plane went in, and it was one of the most intense battles of the Vietnam War. And, you know, what I've learned over the years is that it was a devastating day for the Blassie family, May 11th of 1972, but it was a really bad day for a lot of Vietnam veterans during that battle over An Lac. And so, you know, I've come out of myself a little bit more. You know, May 11th isn't just about the Blassies, it's about what these men were doing in Vietnam to answer the call. So I look at that, and I'm very thankful for our Vietnam veterans and what they did and what they stand for. I left out the rest of my family. Michael was the oldest. My sister Judy is next in line, and then my sister Mary, who's the middle. I'm number four, and then George, it was the fifth child. We were born to George and Jean Blassie, and my sister Judy was a flight attendant at the time. They got her home. My sister Mary came home because she was supposed to be driving me to an appointment. So she came home, and Mrs. Leeser actually went and got George. He was at his elementary school. And but George just was like, he knew something was wrong. And he's even younger than me. He's 2.5, 3 years younger than me. So we were just like reeling with what was happening that day. It was sort of interesting because when back then, if you recall, and I'm sure you will, most everyone would, you know, when you go to the airport, you could go to the gate. You know, it wasn't like today. And so when we took Michael there, and he looked back and he waved and gave us that smile, you know, as a 14-year-old, I had no idea that it would be the last time that I would see him, but I didn't understand the war. And it's not like my family, we sat around the kitchen table and talked about the war. It just wasn't what we but we did, unfortunately. So I didn't understand the implications of him going off. Michael was the apple of my mom and dad's eye, and the four of us looked right up to him. You know, he would write letters to us and encourage us to exercise, encourage us to do well in our studies. And so when we were told that he had been shot down and killed and he wasn't coming home and there was no remains, we just, unfortunately, we just shut down ourselves, and we all were sort of dealing with it in our own ways. My mother was reminded that she had to go, she needed to go back to work, and she had four other children. My father, you know, was devastated just in so many different ways. And so we didn't deal with it as a typical family would deal with something like that. So I remember us going to a memorial at Sky Air Force Base. The Air Force put that on for us. So that there would be some element of closure. And anything that we did was always around Michael, whether it was his, when he graduated from the academy, we got in the car, we went to his graduation. When he got his pilot wings, we got in the car, we went to Mississippi for him to get his pilot wings. They asked my mother and father a year after Michael was killed that they wanted to name a building at Columbus Air Force Base after Michael. We got in the car and we went and we were at that dedication. It was things like that that we did. But other than that, my father dealt with it in his own way. He had a trophy case built downstairs, and all of Michael's medals and his flag and the things, his accomplishments were put in that trophy case. And so it was something that he spent a lot of time downstairs. So that's what he did. That was, you know, and again, going back to, we didn't have that closure. And I know people don't like to use that word. I'm not sure there's a better one. We just didn't know the rest of the story. It was in 1994, Kathy, that my mother received a call from a man named Ted Sampley, and he's a former Marine, Green Beret, and very radical, didn't believe that our government was honest with us about POWs and MIAs, believed that we'd knowingly left people in Vietnam. He would go and protest in different ways up in Washington. So he had a very radical reputation. It wasn't, I would say, how would I say, some people just did not agree with his tactics.
Yeah.
And so, but when he called my mother, he said, I read a book by Susan Sheehan, and it's called A Missing Plane. And Susan Sheehan had gone to the Central Identification Lab in Hawaii and was learning how the Central Identification Lab was identifying remains and how they were, you know, once they found them, wherever they found them in Vietnam or wherever, that they would bring them to Hawaii and how they would identify them and then get them home to the families. Mm. Well, in the case of the unknown soldier, there's three or four paragraphs in that book about the day the unknown soldier was shot down and killed, about what was found with the unknown soldier and where the unknown soldier was found, what day, where, how many remains was with him, and the approximate height and age. Back then they didn't have DNA, they did this anthropological formula where they sort of, and I could not explain it, but that whatever they did, they would tell you approximate age and approximate height of the person. And in this book, those three paragraphs, very telling information, but it also talked about how the National League of Families asked them to come to Washington to ask a couple of the people that worked at the lab to come to Washington and say, it's a good thing to have an unknown soldier. And they would not do that in this book, it says. And so that was published in 1986, 2 years after the unknown soldier was interred in the tomb. So when Ted read that book, he said, Mrs. Blassie, and this was like a bombshell to my mom, you know, he said, I did some research and I believe it's your son. It was this, you know, the same day as Michael was shot down, it was Air Force items that were found, an ID card was found. And so my mother asked him to talk to me. I was in the military at the time and a captain. And I talked to him and I said, Mr. Sampley, this is the craziest thing, you know, in the world. How can there be a known soldier in the tomb of the unknowns? And, you know, that just doesn't make sense in any of our minds. And so I said, I will call. He goes, do some research, look at it. So I called the Air Force Casualty Office at Randolph Air Force Base, which is where the Air Force Personnel Center still is today. And I asked them the question. I said, they're saying that my brother is in the Tomb of the Unknowns. He has been found and interred. And this, you know, 10 years earlier in 1984. And I said, is this true? And they said, there's nothing to substantiate that your brother's in the Tomb of the Unknowns. And I said, thank you very much, because that would be just, you know, the craziest thing that I could ever imagine happen, you know, that we would allow happen. When you look at the tomb, it says known but to God, and there's a process for that. So we accepted that answer from the Air Force, but 3 years later, then Vince Gonzalez called. He's an investigative reporter. And he said, I looked at Mr. Sampley's article that he published in his news dispatch. And he said, I think he's right. I've done some research. And so at that point, Kathy, I said, my mother cannot get, you know, phone calls like this. This is very, very difficult for us as a family, and particularly for my mom. And so when I talked to her, my mom, her name is Jean, I said, you know, what about signing an affidavit that Vince could do the research, and any document with Michael's name on it, nobody else was researching it, Vince could get his hands on it, because I'm not, you know, an investigative reporter, and he was really on it. And so she did, and a lot of documents, we were absolutely amazed, the decisions that were made on behalf of my mom and dad and Michael with regard to his name, with regard to his remains, and then it ends up being true. When you find out truths, it's very difficult to deal with the truth, but as we went through this, we would rather know the truth. But what we came to find out is that Michael was shot down and killed on May 11th of 1972. It was October 31st of the same year, just a few months later, that a Vietnamese reconnaissance team went into Michael's crash site with U.S. Army officers to find Michael. There's a document. It was very clear, and they found him. And he made it to the U.S. mortuary in Saigon. And so there's a document that somebody signed for Michael. They signed for his remains. They signed for his artifacts. And they said there was an ID card. And so then it went from there. As time went on, I guess the best way I could explain it without, it would be a long time, we'd have to talk, but that it just kept compounding the decisions that were made. That was in 1972. In 1978, the next thing I would like to share with you is that they wrote a letter and said that, you know, the remains that belong to Michael Blassie, we can't say that it's him because he missed the mark for a half an inch on height. He missed the mark for the 2 years in his age. And they had found a hair that didn't match Michael's blood type. But that was after 6 years sitting on a shelf. So they recommended that his name be taken away from him. So a board met 2 years later. His name was taken away from those remains in 1980. And then it went on from there. And So those remains were the ones that were identified to be placed in the tomb. And on that day, Memorial Day, 1984, when I look at those pictures of what was going on in Washington, D.C., and President Reagan presiding over the ceremony and accepting the flag as the family member on behalf of a nation, that was my brother Michael. And it was very clear in the documents. And so with that much clarity, we met as a family to decide what to do. I was working directly with Vince. And as soon as I called my mom, because it was getting pretty serious as we were looking at documents. And as Vince was doing more research than the Pentagon, you know, the Freedom of Information Act, and you know how those entities, they talked to one another. So they knew there was research being done on the Tomb of the Unknowns and Michael. But I put binders together and I asked my mom to call us all together. And we sat in her apartment. She was in an apartment at the time. And it was the first time we started talking about Michael and the letters that he wrote us. And we were like, but look at these documents. So what do we want to do? And then we started sharing stories. And like George said, this is sacred ground. What a high honor to be buried at the Tomb of the Unknowns. We talked about that, you know, and yeah, it's an honor, but for someone who is unknown. And then right. My sister Mary went, she's the middle, and she was like, I just know that if I was lost, Michael would come find me. So we talked about that. I mean, so everybody's dealing with all these different kinds of issues. And Judy was, we're all critical as Blassies, but Judy just laid it on the line. You know, I don't think anybody cares. Years we've been wondering about Michael, and still getting letters in the mid 90s that they're going back into Vietnam to find him, you know, to do missions to find him. And but they hadn't told us that he had already been found in October of 72. So we dealt with all of that. And then George also came up with, wait a second, Michael's a hero. He deserves to be known, you know? And then we talked about what's in a name, you know, and you know, what is this about unknown? And we think about the Vietnam Veterans Memorial with all those names and what that means to us. It's a person with a family, with, you know, either children or spouses, or, I mean, there's so much to a name, but they had taken Michael's name away from him. And so so we looked at each other, but and my mother was very patient, but very on the inside, such a strong will about what she wanted done. And she goes, looks at her children after we stopped our bantering. And she said, I want to bring my son home. I want him to have his own tombstone with his name on it. And so it was at that point we made a pact as a family. We didn't know exactly what it would entail, but we said we would stand strong together and we would honor her request. And so we went public in January of 1998 saying, we want to know the truth. The trail leads to the tomb, and we want to bring Michael home.
Wow.
Once we went public, Secretary Defense Cohen at the time, he put together a task force. And this task force started researching the same documents that we looked at, and I'm sure more. But after they did their research, looking at the same documents and more, and talking to more people than we had access to, they made the recommendation to Secretary Cohen to open the tomb. And at the time I was saying, yeah, we'll do DNA testing. I didn't even really know what DNA testing was. The secretary took the recommendation, they opened the tomb, they did the DNA test, they called my mother. That was January 19th of 1998 when we went public. They called my mother on June the 30th to let her know that she could finally bring her son home after 26 years, because it was one of the closest matches that the DNA experts had seen at that time. It was a journey for me personally. And, you know, because I was very proud to wear the uniform. But as we talked about, truths are difficult to deal with. And so at a certain point, I was like, I am getting out. And thankfully, there is a great and mighty God who gets a hold of us sometimes and shakes us and puts some sense into us. And because this situation was overflowing into every area of my life where I was just not trusting anybody. I was becoming bitter. And you know, I know we all can do that, but that's really not my tendency. But I had to learn to, this is one event, see it for what it is, learn from it. This was the Lord maybe, it made me learn this. To compartmentalize this situation and then to say, I don't want this to happen to anybody else. So any mission that I'm put on as an officer, I will do my best to ensure that people are taken care of in the right way. So I didn't get out. And I'm very grateful that that my mind changed about how to deal with this. Because I would have never accomplished what I have accomplished, and I'm very thankful for my Air Force training. Because if I didn't have my Air Force training, I couldn't have helped my family. So I would have been throwing a lot away. And so anyway, to your point, it was difficult.
Well, I'm certain it had to have been just a tremendously difficult thing for you to process. And I don't think you would have been human had you not gone through that veil of tears, if you will, that very difficult processing of it, you know, and gone through that feeling of resentment almost, you know, and gotten quasi bitter and then learned the lesson on the other side. Of course, that is a tribute to your strength of character right there. And of course, the way that this all plays out then, that on July 11th of 1998, your brother Mike finally came home to Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery here in St. Louis. Tell us about that day. It had to have been so bittersweet for your family. Tell us about that.
It was. I don't think any of us will ever forget how important that day was, especially to my mom. When we arrived at Jefferson Barracks and saw the number of people that had come to join us in the celebration of Michael's life and his service, there were, from what I've been told, there was 4,000 to 5,000 people there. And people who had never buried their the person that they served with in Vietnam, the flight lead of Michael's mission, the lady we thought he would marry, his roommate from Vietnam, people from the academy who knew him, and they wanted to have that that closure as well. The one of the Army officers who went into Michael's crash site to find him came to see that his mission had been accomplished, even though it was 26 years later, because he had found him and put him on that helicopter. He was there. So it was a day where it just seemed absolutely beautiful, but it was also a day where we were like, we won, we found him. But then it was like, oh my gosh, he really is, you know, we're dealing with his death this long afterwards. And so there was just a range of emotions, but the bottom line was, we really do believe that it was the right thing to do.
Absolutely.
The Tomb of the Unknowns is sacred ground again, from our perspective. My mother was satisfied with bringing Michael home. And for my sister, Judy, Mary, and my brother, George, and I, we continue to grow from this, and we learn more about Michael As the years go on, it's just a story that continues to unfold for us. So we're very thankful for how it worked, even though it was a very difficult scenario getting to where we needed to be. I told somebody recently, one of his classmates, I said, but you guys knew him differently and better. And I'm learning from your stories to get to know him in a different way, even though it's not personally. So it's been a real blessing. It truly has been.
What are your thoughts on the value to our young people and to our citizenry of having a resource such as the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum?
I just believe, and I know it's not just about Michael, but Michael's story is unique, and indeed. But it is one of hope for others who are still waiting to find out the rest of the story about their loved ones, and you know whether they were POW or missing in action, or you know sometimes our government's like, well, you know we don't have all of the information, so we don't tell. But I really believe families can handle information. But it comes back to, though, that we don't forget that they are, it's not just a name over here. It's somebody who served, somebody who had a life. And they sort of become real as we remember them. And so to me, what Paul and his board at, for the museum, and what Russ and Michael's classmates are doing to bring that reality to the, whether it's the young people or people who don't really know about POWs and MIAs, and you know, but it's just so important that we don't forget, that we never forget. So to me, what they're doing is just a wonderful tribute to all who have served in one way or another.
Thank you, Colonel Blassie. It is now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Russell E. McKnight, a classmate of Lieutenant Michael J. Blassie at the United States Air Force Academy, and also Vietnam War veteran. It was happenstance, perhaps fate, or maybe even something more celestial, that brought Russ, a logistics expert and a former B-52 pilot, to the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum. Since the day he visited, Russ has been a dynamic force in the restoration and promotion of this unique museum and the stories it holds. For 2 years, Russ had contemplated collecting stories about Lieutenant Michael J. Blassie from the perspective of those who knew him at the Academy. But this proclamation and virtual tribute of this May 11th proved to be an even more providential opportunity. In the interviews, Russ shares a picture of the face of the class of 1970. Here, through the eyes of his classmates, is Mike, as his classmates knew him. Russell, it is always a pleasure to see you. Thank you for being with us this morning. How did you become involved in the restoration of the museum?
In 2018, my classmate, Charles Black, gave me a call and asked if I would join 20 other classmates in a hood to coast relay race. This was going to be 200 miles long. He said, "We're all members of the class of 1970. We're all at least 70 years old. And it's the 70th anniversary of the Air Force as a separate service. How could I say no?" Our relay team went on to raise $60,000 for cancer research. On the cross-country trip to Mount Hood, my wife and I stopped at the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum to visit our old friend, Paul Dillon. Paul asked me when I was there if I knew Mike Blassie, a local hero. And I said, yes, Mike was my classmate. Paul then showed me a memorial paver at the base of the flagpole. And that moment in time became a defining moment for me. I asked Paul if our class could help the museum restoration in any way. And Paul said, yep, we can't open this museum until the three porches are restored. Our generous class again stepped up, 150 donations totaling $50,000, honoring and remembering Mike. And also, our fellow classmates killed in action and taken prisoner of war. I called Dick Rauschkopf, and he referred me to Jim Nance, who is really quite renowned in bronze sculpture work. Jim is a graduate of the class of 1971. He designed and produced this stunning plaque for us. It not only commemorates Mike's sacrifice and his continued service to our country as the unknown soldier, but also remembers his brother airmen who gave their lives in Vietnam or served as prisoner of war. The POWs, Jocko Trimble and William J. Tiny Reich. Reich was taken prisoner on 11 May, 1972, and the very same day that Mike and John Hazelton died. And Trimble was shot down on 27 December, 1972.
It seems to me that the 11th of May, 1972 was a very difficult day for your class for the Air Force.
Yeah, it's truly our class Memorial Day.
And that makes perfect sense, absolutely. Why is this museum restoration so meaningful for your class?
Well, Mike represents timeless attributes that characterize our class: unbridled enthusiasm, fearlessness, commitment, independence, and empathy. A leader by example. Ray Barlaban recently told me that when he was on the field, he just tried to imitate Mike. Be your best, be like Mike. The class of 1970, including all the men you will see in the next few minutes, is known as the Heritage Class. In addition to supporting the Hood to Coast fundraiser and the POW-MIA Museum, we funded, designed, and oversaw the construction of the Southeast Asia Memorial Pavilion and the Plaza of Heroes at the Academy. Mike is one of those heroes. Be your best. Be like Mike.
Very moving words, Russell. Would you kindly introduce us to several of your classmates?
Yeah. I'd be happy to do that. And let me explain why we are using photographs from 1970. The photos you will see in the following interviews show how we looked when we knew Mike. The prisoners of war look as they did when captured. The killed in action appear as they did when they died 50 years ago. Our first interview is with John Martinson. John has founded enterprises and served as the director for more than 55 other companies in his career. He has received honorary doctorates from several universities and was named as an Academy Distinguished Graduate in 2008 for lifetime achievement and philanthropy. In the fall of 1966, John was Mike Blassie's first semester roommate at the Air Force Academy. Remember, this was a very challenging time for a new cadet, and Mike helped John get through this first year. John recounts life lessons for us that he learned from Mike.
Mike entered, and I entered at the same time. Freshman year, we were roommates along with a third young man. Mike and I became fast friends. We both came from suburban communities. He's in St. Louis and mine a New York suburb. But we had a lot of the same values, middle class values, same desire to succeed, similar balance between academics and sports. And he was always upbeat and positive. He was never had a negative word or dispersion of anyone. He was the most positive person, I think, to this day I've ever met. He was a tremendously in shape. He was in better physical shape than me. And then I concluded if I stayed, could hung with him, I'd be great. But he was a top flight soccer player, played all 4 years at the academy, was captain, a high scorer, and he could run, and run some more. Other roommate disliked the academy immensely. And Mike and I each took it upon as our mission to try to turn that around and try to be a threesome. And I think for both of us, one of our disappointments is that cadet resigned four times and we turned him around. And then the fifth time, the leadership said, no more, he's going to have to go. So and we would double date quite a bit. I remember one time we were matched up. And I was about 4 inches taller than Mike. So we had to swap dates because of height. And he went on dating the shorter girl for a couple of years. You know, I would go watch him play soccer. And he was a mild-mannered, enthusiastic guy. On the soccer field, he really had a terror about him and a determination. He was a different person, fully focused, concentrated, and he was a very physical but fast player. I learned a lot from that, that you can adapt. You know, you need to have your basic character, but you can adapt to different levels of intensity. He certainly one of my role models in life, even though it's a long time away, but he influenced me positively in so many ways that I didn't fully appreciate at the time. But he made that probably the most demanding year in my life much more pleasant all of his encouragement and fine examples day in and day out.
Major General Marvin J. Berry has been an instructor, flight examiner, operations officer, and commander of a tactical airlift squadron during Operation Desert Storm. He has served as assistant to the Chief of the Air Force Reserve, a command pilot in C-130s and the C-5A Galaxy. He also has 9,000 civilian hours in the Boeing 757 and 767ER. Jay tells an amusing story about kicking the ball around with Mike.
And Mike and I were roommates in assigned training. And you know, Mike was quite a person, and had one of those dry and unusual sense of humor. And after we were training the dualies a few days, he came to me and said, "Hey Jay, you know, why don't you and I play this good cop bad cop with the dualies?" And he said, "I can be the good cop." And I said, "Okay, I'll be the bad cop." And we had a lot of fun with that. Of course, at the dualies' expense, but it was a lot of fun. Mike was also a big-time soccer player, went on to great things at the academy. And in our off times, when we have a couple hours, he'd say, "Hey, Jay, how'd you like to come down and help me? I'm going to kick the soccer ball around." Well, I thought, hey, you know, I'm a big-time football, baseball, basketball player. I can handle a soccer ball. And we went down around the Terrazzo area, in between the dorms, and we started kicking the ball around, and I'm telling you, he left me standing there, if you excuse the expression, with my jock in hand so many times that it was funny. But he was determined to make a passable soccer player out of me. And through that time, we practiced off and on, and I got to be pretty good, mainly because I could kick a ball like you wouldn't believe. But that was an interesting time with Mike. And after that, we, throughout the academy years, we kept in contact. And then I go to Southeast Asia, and Mike, as it turns out, I got there December of 71. Mike got there about the same time. And then the Easter Offensive began, and Mike was in the, I believe it was the 8th Special Operations Squadron, stationed at Ben Hua, flying A-37s. He's doing a lot of missions every day in support of that Easter offensive around the city of An Lạc. And at the same time, April and May, I was very heavily involved in the resupply of An Lạc, doing low-level, high-level, day, night missions, dropping cargo in a 130. And I heard on May 11th, a day or so after, that he had been shot down, and they made a real attempt to recover him, but he was supporting the An Lạc offensive, and he was really in the middle of real bad guy territory. Now, understand, the North Vietnamese and the Viet Cong had 3 divisions, 30,000 people surrounding An Lạc, and in that area was where he was shot down.
John Bailey knew Mike during our basic cadet summer and relates how Mike came to be on the Academy NCAA tennis team. John flew numerous Air Force aircraft, including the OV-10 in Vietnam, and retired from the Air Force. He went on to become a Boeing 747 check pilot.
Michael had an understanding during basic training that the dog trot style of jogging that is done in combat boots in the military may do something for your conditioning, but it's disastrous for the muscles in your lower legs, for the spring in your legs. And it's kind of like you're jackhammering your legs into concrete, and they don't spring so much after that. I could go up and dunk a basketball 2 hands behind my head before, when I showed up at the academy. By the end of basic training, I could barely touch the rim. And that is exactly, Michael knew that beforehand, not my dilemma, but he knew that it would tear up his legs. And so as you can imagine, a squadron of cadets, double timing as they called it, running around in combat boots. Michael, I was the tallest, so I was the element leader. John Martinson was an inch or two shorter than I, so he was second in our element, and Michael was third. I can still hear to this day the sound of the upperclassmen yelling, "Get back in ranks, Blassie!" Because Michael, where we would all be running single file, you know, in ranks, Michael would be off to the side. He'd be loping as we were doing this. He would be doing that. He would be loping and saving his legs. And he did that every single time an upperclassman wasn't just right on top of him, and he would get out of there. Another little side tidbit about Michael, as I say, he was an All-American soccer player, and they had very good soccer teams in those days. He was also a great tennis player, from my perspective. I didn't know how great. I heard him as we were roommates, you know, because I was on the freshman tennis team, and I heard him talking about two people that he had beaten or taken into extra sets and lost in the St. Louis University area. One was the number one guy in the 16 and under in the nation, and the other guy was like number two in the 18 and under. And I thought, I got eliminated in my state high school tournament in Iowa every year in my district because the guy who beat me won the state championship. He just happened to live in my district. But I was on the freshman team, and I was probably number seven or eight on the team, quite frankly. And we hadn't yet played any matches. And I had been trying to get Michael to come down and show me that he was this good. I thought he was just BSing me. No, he was that good. 9 months since he had last touched a racket, I borrowed another guy's racket on a Sunday afternoon. We went down to the cadet tennis courts and played. He beat me 6-love, 6-2. And I think he gave me one game just to not embarrass me further. And I realized this guy is really way out of my league good, and convinced him to then, he was doing off-season conditioning and training for soccer. It wasn't their on-season time of the year. Convinced him to come play freshman tennis, and he did. And he became the number two player within a week on the freshman tennis team. And he then became the number two player on the varsity.
Richard Brom Smith flew choppers and went to intelligence school for the Air Force. Later, Brom earned an advanced degree from the Harvard Business School and entered into the banking business, helping both congressmen and corporations understand and craft sensible regulations. Like Mike, Brom was a gifted athlete who played on our academy soccer teams with Mike all 4 years. Brom shares insights regarding the championship teams Mike led and what it was like to be on the field with Mike.
I guess if I was going to take lessons away from the academy, it was the value, if you would, of teamwork, and especially in the athletic construct. Because the Air Force Academy had a lot of good guys, but individually, they were not as good as many of the players we played against. But together as a team, because of the practice, the teamwork, and the conditioning, we were pretty good. Mike, as I described him to others, he was like the royalty of the soccer team. I mean, he was that good. He and another fellow played, midfield. And I was a journeyman. So I was happy to be on the field, playing and I got to play a lot. But you know, Mike and this other fellow were kind of the drivers, and you know, they led by example. They were probably the captains, and they were good to be around. And it was always funny to be, you know, sometimes you're in those circles with a soccer ball and you're trying to kick it around a little bit, not hard, but you know, keep it in the air, for example. And he was, you know, he was probably the best in that because he just had the natural talent. Now, he came from St. Louis, and St. Louis, like Rochester, New York, or Winchester, Pennsylvania, at the time, were really hot spots for boys' kid soccer. And, you know, he was exemplary there. The other thing about Mike, in addition to the soccer, I don't know if it gets as much play, is that Mike also was, to the best of my memory, was a varsity tennis player. There are not too many people at the academy who were two-letter men in varsity. So that just gives you an idea of how gifted he was as an athlete. Mike had to be among, if not the coolest guy on the soccer team. I mean, he looked, you know, he's very good looking, kind of quiet, kind of that little shyness, but I don't think so. It could have been part of his persona, you know, dressed okay. And he was really cool. I mean, just by being there, he had that presence, that demeanor of being, you know, really, really cool. And you could even see a little of that, I think, on the soccer field, because he was not one of these rah-rah guys. He wasn't, you know, he didn't go into your, like, if I missed a play, he wouldn't come up to my face and, you know, say, Brom, what are you doing? You know, any of that stuff. He would, you know, he was a team player and he always tried to do it. You know, he'd get frustrated more at himself than he would at, you know, somebody like me. So you know, he was really just really, really cool.
Delbert R. Chip Terrell retired as a Washington administrative law judge at the U.S. International Trade Commission, an intellectual property litigator, and was the founder and president of the Washington International Soccer League for 40 years. Chip shares with us what it was like to compete with Mike using pugil sticks and how Mike shared his passion for soccer with Chip. In 1984, Chip paid his respects to the unknown, laying in state in the U.S. Capitol Rotunda. Honoring Mike as witness, yet not knowing he was actually with Mike that day. Thank you, Chip.
Well, Mike and I were both in Digger Squadron. At the academy, there were 24 squadrons divided up into three groups of three squadron each. So there was eight squadron. Digger was named after the diggers and the fillers at the academy. It was always under construction. It was always the diggers were digging something up and the fillers were putting it back. So we 10th, 11th, and 12th were in Digger. Mike was in 11th and I was in 12th. So we were in the same dually training squadron for everything, first and second BCTs. We went through everything together, the confidence course, the way we ran for time, HELSAF Ager, as it was called. We did the confidence course where there were all these contraptions that you had to accomplish, and some quite scary, actually. I drew him in the pugil stick competition. And I was a good boxer at the academy. I had quick hands. I boxed in the wing open. I only lost to the champ and who won the wing open championship. So I was quick of foot, quick of hands. But Mike was incredible. He hit me before I could do anything. I still to this day, and I should have realized that a guy that was a varsity tennis player and a varsity soccer player was going to outdo me in foot speed. But I don't think I ever touched him. He hammered me so many times, I was dazed by the time he was done with me. So that was my first Michael Blassie experience. But, you know, but Mike was a phenomenal athlete. People, I don't know how many appreciated how good an athlete he was, because he was a six-letter winner at the academy, which is really unusual. And he was the only senior on the tennis team. So he was the only guy to go 3 years on in varsity tennis, but his love was soccer. And he did 3 years varsity soccer as well. January of 68, marched a bunch of tours together at the academy. And tours are where you march with your rifle for 50 minutes with a 10-minute break in between it. And he and I marched at least 4 to 6 weeks together out there in the middle of the bitter cold of Colorado winter. And where they had us marching was in what we called the wind tunnel, where the wind blew right through the area of the dorms. And on a break, the other thing I remember about Mike, he showed me his shoes, and he said, "I never untie my shoes. I can slide right into them to go out to formation." He had crushed down the rear of his heel of his shoes so he could literally slide into his to go out to formation quickly. And you know, I wish I'd, you know, designed that or taken that. I wish I'd known patent law at that time. And, you know, everybody buys this concept now. And he would, the first person I ever knew that had this idea was Mike Blassie. So, but the other thing about the tours was that, you know, after 3 hours of marching tours from 1 to 4 o'clock, I was pretty exhausted. And I would go back to my room and lay down, and we called our bed our rack. And I go to get in my rack, put my feet up to get the blood out of my legs. And within a half an hour, I'd hear this booming against the wall right below my room. And it was Blassie kicking his soccer ball, which he was well known for. Starting in the fall of night when we were dualies on weekends, he would be down there kicking that ball. And I'm sure everyone in our class remembers Blassie's. And so this went on for like 4 or 5 weeks. And I kept sliding the window open from my dorm room. And I'm going, "Blassie, I'm trying to sleep. For Christ's sake, will you stop kicking the ball?" He didn't go, "Well, I don't have anybody to kick with. Come on down and kick the ball." I mean, so about the last week, I relented and went down and started kicking the ball around. And, I loved it. And so he said, "You go out for your intramural soccer team this spring, you know." He said, "You know, everybody knows you're quick and fast." He said, "You know, you might have a chance to play on with me on the team." So I played soccer that intramural, and I fell in love with the sport. And as a result, I swore as soon as I got out of the academy, I was going to start playing soccer and amateur wise. And so he gave me the gift of my avocation, which has been soccer. I've run a soccer league since 1980. So 40 some years in, I've been running a soccer league in tribute to Mike. I finally put it up on a website, and to Mike and my brother, they both got me. One got me into soccer and the other one kept me there.
Colonel Steve Mac McIsaac has represented fighting men in Vietnam and every conflict since then. Mac took an AC-119K gunship out of flight school, and in early May 1972, Mac's squadron was quickly reassigned to augment the defense of An Lạc during the Easter Offensive. Things were not going well, and the intelligence was sketchy. 3 divisions of North Vietnamese regulars had An Lạc surrounded. We begin this interview just as Mac recognizes Mike ahead of him in line at the chow hall.
Of course, here's Mike Blassie, classmate of mine. He'd just thrown 4 missions that day at An Lạc, and he wanted to say, "You son of a bitch," and he could have picked me up by that collar and just throw me out, which would have been the proper thing to do. And it took us about 30 seconds to, "Oh, hi, how are you? Yeah, I'm so, oh yeah, yeah, I thought, yeah, you know, I thought I saw you before the other night, yeah, done." So, but we soon figured out, because he would literally have the ground's truth of what's going on at An Lạc, because he was on his 2nd, 3rd, 4th mission of every day, had parked his jet for the day. He swung by to get something hot to eat, and then he knew he was going to go through. But he was a daylight attack pilot. So he's working the same altitudes, same things, same facts, same everything. So he became a wealth of knowledge for me. But then I was always able to tell him, well, here's what our guys faced last night and where, because pretty much the town got cut up into sectors or regions, you know, south on the river by the bridge or north on this, you know, so guys could just visually, mentally pick up the geography in their minds, because after a while there, you know it, you grow it, it becomes part of you, you know. We said, well, yeah, and it was on one of those things that I mentioned it to. Yeah, since they brought that 37 millimeter down that got my roommate, they drug it down near the bridge by the river down south of town. I remember having that discussion, among other things, you know. Yeah, we backed off now. We're going up there in the dark. We're still getting our ass shut off because they are bringing in more and more 23s and 37s, nothing bigger than that, but in a small area with a lot of planes stacked up and not a lot of options for bailing out of getting away from things. You could easily break off a gun and break into somebody else's patterns in a bomb run or another run of some kind. So it was becoming very, very hazardous, to say the least. I mean, there's no other way to put it. So I tell him, you know, because I always had to debrief my crews, make that drag call once a day to 7th, 13th, you know, make sure they weren't going to screw us again with something. And then, you know, give same information I had to them. Well, I was just giving it first to Mikey because he was there, you know, and I knew that oh, dark 30 in the morning, probably when our last gunship was coming off, he would be checking in, or one of his guys, one of his dragons would be checking in and picking up where we left off. And so it was a pretty good marriage. I want to say this went on for, I want to say easily 5 or 6 days. And it was, became very, I mean, routine. I mean, it was just, you wouldn't even start in the food line till you hooked up with the other guy and then you'd go. You know, sometimes we ate, sometimes we didn't eat. All depending, because he had time, I never did, because I had to press on to meet a briefing or a phone call or something. But it got to be a lot of fun in some respects. It took a lot, a little pressure off, created a lot of valuable valuable information, I thought. I passed everything he gave on me onto my crews. I suspect he threw the bullshit flag on some of his intel briefings and said, well, don't worry about, you know, well, what do you want to tell me about the 37 down by the bridge? Well, there's no 37 down there. Well, I think there, you know, so he had knowledge that the ground pounded non-flying intel guy, Tots Newt, either didn't have or didn't incorporate. So I roll in one night and I'm sitting there, I'm watching my clock and looking, and, you know, finally I see a few other dragonfly guys come in and go. And I said, hey, anybody seen Mike? Nobody picks up a head, nobody says a word. And I said, well, okay. You know, it was not uncommon to divert to Tonson Newt, which was close, or to another other base, or your fact handed you off to some hot spot, you know, right next door in Play Coup or the Parrot Speak or somewhere, you know, and then you would land there, recycle, you know. So it was not uncommon. The guys would not necessarily come back to their base. We always tried to come back to our base because that was the only place to have our maintenance. So, but then on day two, I'm there, same time, a little earlier this time, thinking maybe his time got changed. And I'm sitting there, I'm not in line, but I'm where everybody would go to join the line. I said, hey, anybody seen Mike Blassie? You know, I'm talking to everybody in the channel, you know. And then this voice over back behind me says, he bought the farm. And everybody's, that was the term, very common knowledge term. And he followed that, he bought the farm with no shoot, no beeper, meaning he'd gone straight in. And that was it. Skipped shell that night, went and flew that night, went on and flew it about another 4 or 5 times. Finally rotated back to knock on Phnom, started flying back to PDJ again, and pulled a tour over Da Nang, got enough hours, came back to NKP again, picked up my own crew, finished off my tour. But that was life the way it was. Here today, gone tomorrow, no time to dwell. Now, I did carry a little monkey on my back for years and years and years, because I remember telling him about the gun down by the bridge. And then rumors over the years passed on that he was on his third or fourth mission a day, which was, that was Mike. Mike would volunteer for anything and everything. He was fearless. That he might have been going after that gun. So I carried that monkey around for a little bit. That monkey went away one day when I was nearing the end of my career. We'll fast forward now. We're back to up to 1997 now, 98, somewhere in that time frame. I'm down at McDill Field in Tampa, Florida. I open up the Sunday paper. Lo and behold, one of the pictures on there is that they've interned the To the Unknown Vietnam Soldier. And sure enough, in that tomb, and he'd been there for, looking out after me for a long time, was Mike. We all flew in a day when there was no such thing as DNA. And on that particular day, I want to say it was somewhere the 10th, 11th May, days ran together, Zulu time, whatever. That particular day, at Ann Lock, we lost a total of 13 aircraft. Most of them were helicopters, 2 or 3 were fixed wings. We lost 26 great American aviators, Mike being one of them. The battle went on. Battle went on that night. I can honestly say that when I walked away from Ann Lock, it had been recovered by the forces of the Republic of South Vietnam, and the bad guys had been driven back into the Parrot Peaks and had retreated back to Cambodia. Sure.
Lieutenant General Tom Doc Waskow flew 282 combat missions as a forward air controller in Vietnam. His storied career concluded as the commander, U.S. Forces Japan, and commander, 5th Air Force. Doc was in the airspace when we lost Mike. He describes the air battle over Ann Lock and the courage of the men who fought there. Doc reminds us that we lost John Hazelton on that same dreadful day.
Mike Blassie, as Hawk 02, was the wingman for Hawk Flight, which was a pre-fragged flight, which tells me that he had flown his first sortie in the morning and he had literally landed, rearmed, refueled, and got airborne again because the activity was so intensive that we had to get all of the close air support airplanes in there because the enemy was in the wire, and they were doing CBU 25, which was what Mike was carrying when he was shot down. And they were doing all the level dangerous stuff because of the need for absolute precision to break the back of this final thrust to try and capture the town. So when I heard that a Hawk 02 had taken a hit, he said, he's down. And I immediately had this sinking feeling. I knew exactly who it was. And when something like that happens, you know, your mind goes into hyperdrive, and I say, all right, let's turn around and go back up. And I'm looking at my gas, and I had about half an hour fuel left, and just nothing I could do. So I had trust in the rest of my fellow squadron mates that they were going to do whatever we could do, because if he's down there, we'll find him, we'll get him out, because we'll stop whatever we're doing and put whatever resources we had into saving him. In fact, as it turned out, we had another FAC shot down, bailed out, and the Arvin on the ground picked him up and brought him back into town. He spent 30 days on the ground talking to us on the radio until we could get him out. In Mike's case, it was a 51 cal, we think, that stitched the airplane, and it was inverted, and there was very little chance for survival. So as it turned out, and the other byline is a story that I don't think anybody knows, but he was being worked by one of our facts whose call sign was Chico-11, Barry Allman is his name. And Barry was working Mike, he saw the whole thing, and he was the one that reported to Pawnee Target, you know, our command and control element, what he saw. And he did the best he could to try and sanitize the crash site with fighters, but he said there's just very little chance of survival. And he was absolutely distraught. And so you could hear it on his voice on guard while he was working it as I was coming home. And you could tell he was distressed. Well, he called Pawnee Target and they said, and he said, I'm RTB. And they said, no, you're not. I want you to go back up to Anlock and continue your mission. Well, he did. And about 30 minutes later, he was shot down also. And so to make the situation even worse, my roommate, John Hazelton, Sundog 3-4, passed me as I was coming back to Tonsonute, and he was going up to replace Barry, who had been on station for a while, and they accelerated his departure because of losing Barry. And John Hazelton headed up there, and 45 minutes later, he was shot down. So in one day, we lost two O2s and one A37, all of whom were dear friends of mine. Losing Mike was personal for me. Because he was my personal friend.
Thank you, Doc. Jack Jocko Trimble was a champion diver at the Academy and is the keeper of our class battle flag. This flag has climbed Kilimanjaro, run the Hood to Coast relay, and joined in other campaigns and escapades. After Vietnam, Jocko went on to become a lieutenant colonel and retired with 22 years of service. Then he went on and flew another 20 years for FedEx. Here he is.
I first got to know Mike at the Air Force Academy because he and a roommate of mine in my sophomore year named Dave Higgins were playing on the soccer team. And I don't know if Dave went ahead and made the varsity or not, but Mike would come by and talk with him after practice or before. And after we moved to the different squadrons our junior year, I'd see Mike down in the athletic department because I was an athlete also, and bump into him in the halls. And he'd also show up at some of the parties. We had a lot of common friends, parties that we had up in the mountain houses. After graduation, I didn't get a chance to see much of Mike. Mike went off to pilot training, and I and Townsend and Turos and Bill Reich went off to NAV school, and the others went off to pilot training, which is a little bit longer than NAV school. And we worked through our separate curricula and managed to get to fighters or FACs or wherever it was we were going and showed up in Southeast Asia. For my part, I was late getting over there. I left the States on the 29th of March which was the day the North Vietnamese came across the DMZ. Before we went to our operational bases, we had to go through snake school. So I checked in at the BOQ at Clark Air Base, and they put me in a room with another lieutenant. I walked in the door. It's Mike Turos. So he said, "Hey, I'm just heading to the bar. Come on down. Let's go." You see, Mike and Fran Townsend and I were always together at some time or another because we were right next to each other alphabetically. And at any time our first 2 years, we, you know, collected, we formed an alphabetical order. So I saw Mike all through that week, and then I went over to Udorn. And at Udorn, Fran Townsend was there. I believe Pomeroy was there. I didn't see him very often, but Bill Reich was there. And so we got started, and they were all checked out. And I got checked out in April, and then came May. The operations and everything in May were hectic, to say the best part is the North Vietnamese were at An Lock. There was Highway 7 going down to Saigon. There was operations going on in the DMZ. It was chaotic, if you want to look at it that way. Out of Udorn, we were flying triple bangs down to Benoit. We'd fly down, work with a FAC, land at Benoit, load up internal fuel and bombs, work with another FAC, and then go back to Benoit, load up, and then go up north and work on the way home to Udorn. We did that time and time again. I did that on the 9th, and again, I think on the 12th. After that, the summer was a blur. It was like fly and eat and fly and eat. Prepare to go north, prepare to go south, wherever you had to go. I kept looking at the board. We lost guys in my squadron, and I know other planes went down at Udorn. But then when I saw Steve Gravrock's name there on the 23rd of July, I said, wow, when's it going to end? Well, it didn't end. Every now and then I'd run into Fran Townsend in the Oak Club and say hi to him and stuff. We were in AF school together. And same thing with Bud Hargrove. You know, Bud was a good friend. We were rivals as far as the 13th and the Triple Nickel go. Bud had already had two MiGs by the end of the summertime. And so 70 was at Udorn, and then Fran Townsend went down on the 13th of August on a recce mission. And he and his pilot were captured. Fran was listed as missing. And I didn't know till I got to Hanoi and saw his front seater, and he told me that Fran had been killed. Then my friend Mike Turos went down on September 17th. And that really hurt. I saw some Iron Hand F-105s refueling the day before he went down, and I wondered if maybe he had been in flight. One of the ones that really hit home to me was when Bud Hargrove went down. We were actually in sort of a lull between linebacker and linebacker two. And in the morning, the day before, I ran into Bud. We sat down and talked over a honey bun that we had for breakfast, and I kidded him about his two MiGs and the way things were going. Great guy. I thought the world of him. And went out and flew that day, and came back in and find out he and his front seater that he had two MiGs with had lost control of the plane and flown into the ground. And it floored everybody. And it affected us operationally too. So it was on December, at the very end of the war, and I gotta tell you, and I'll say it, is I was shot down in the last F-4, Air Force F-4, shot down on the last day of the air war of South Vietnam. And you can say maybe it was bad luck. I guess I have to look at it and say it was good luck. It's better than being shot down on the first day. But there hasn't been a day that's gone by that I haven't thought about the guys on this board and the others that I knew that didn't come home, didn't get the banner parades, didn't have people saying thank you for your service. Right after the war, I was having some trouble adjusting with that. And my father pulled me aside and said, look, Jack, he said, son, I know this bothers you, but they're really not giving you the thanks. It's all for them. And whatever you may feel you're getting, it's for them. And I've tried to live my life that way. And that's the way I feel. And all of these guys deserve our salute. And thank you once again for letting me say a few words.
All I ever wanted to do was fly, leave this world and live in the sky. I left the C-130 out of Fort Worth town. I go up some days, I don't want to come down. Well, I fly that plane called the Angel Flight. Come on, brother, you're with me tonight. Between heaven and earth, you're never alone. On the Angel Flight, come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. Come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. I love my family and I love this land. But tonight this flight's for another man. We do what we do because we heard the call. Some gave a little, but he gave it all. Well, I fly that plane called the Angel Flight. Come on, brother, you're with me tonight. Between heaven and earth, you're never alone. On the Angel Flight, come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. Come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. Well, the cockpit's quiet and the stars are bright. Feels kinda like church in here tonight. It don't matter where we touch down. On the Angel Flight, it's sacred ground. Well, I fly that plane called the Angel Flight. Got a hero riding with us tonight. Between heaven and earth, you're never alone. On the Angel Flight, come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. Come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. Come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home. come on, brother, I'm a-taking you home.
We are honored to welcome a gentleman who is no stranger to the ideals of duty, honor, and courage. A veteran who served 6 years in the United States Army and more than 22 years in law enforcement. This gentleman went on to serve in the Missouri House of Representatives for 6 years and in the Missouri Senate for another six, and then as Lieutenant Governor in 2017-2018. A small business owner and a third-generation farmer who currently owns and works a cattle operation, he stays in touch with his hometown values, his church, and his passion for agriculture, sports, and people. Ladies and gentlemen, the governor of the state of Missouri, the Honorable Michael L. Parson.
Hi, I'm Governor Mike Parson. In honor of the United States Air Force, Lieutenant Michael Joseph Blassie, and in honor of our missing and unaccounted for and their families who bear the burden of great personal loss and agonizing uncertainty, I hereby proclaim May the 11th, 2021 to be Lieutenant Michael Blassie Day in Missouri. On May the 11th, 1972, Lieutenant Blassie's A-37 ground attack aircraft was hit by enemy aircraft fire, causing it to go down in a hostile area near the Cambodian border. No rescue attempt was possible due to an overwhelming enemy presence, and Lieutenant Blassie was officially listed as missing, presumed dead, body not recovered. Lieutenant Michael Blassie's remains were eventually recovered, but were mistakenly classified as unknown, and for 14 years, those remains rested at Arlington National Cemetery in the Vietnam War Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Lieutenant Blassie has since been identified, and his remains were brought to Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery here in St. Louis. So let us honor him and never forget the sacrifices of our brave men and women in the United States Armed Forces. It is a honor and privilege to be the 57th governor of the great state of Missouri. May God bless you, may God bless Missouri, and may God bless the United States of America.
Thank you, Governor Parson. We trust there will be a time in the not too distant future when we'll be able to gather together in person and have a live unveiling of this beautiful proclamation honoring Lieutenant Blassie. We will send out a notice to those who registered today and will keep the museum website updated. We wish to express our gratitude to each of you who has joined us today and participated in today's tribute to Lieutenant Michael J. Blassie. As we've come together to honor his life and memory, it is with the awareness that thousands of brave warriors have made the ultimate sacrifice for our country. We bear in mind that there are countless others who have endured imprisonment behind enemy lines as POWs, and those whose fate is still unknown as MIAs. It is to them and their loved ones that the POW-MIA Museum at Jefferson Barracks is dedicated. By preserving their memory, we not only pay tribute to them, but we also have the opportunity to educate and enlighten generations to come. The qualities of honor, duty, courage, and sacrifice live on in their stories and within the very fabric of our society. The members of the United States Air Force Academy Class of 1970 invite you to join them in supporting this museum. Financial contributions are a necessary part of ensuring that the histories and sacrifices of these many heroes are preserved for all to appreciate. Donations may be made by visiting jbpow-mia.org. That's jbpow-mia.org, and clicking on the Donate tab. All gifts are tax deductible. On behalf of the Blassie family and all of Russell's and Mike's classmates, whose motto is Ense Petit Placidam, by thy sword we seek peace, thank you for your patriotism and for your generous support of the Jefferson Barracks POW-MIA Museum.
out with the people.